Good morning. The Lord be with you. Wonderful to see you in worship. If you did not bring a bulletin with you or pick one up at the back, you can download it onto your mobile device from the web page, from our church's web page. The bulletin will provide you information about Bible boxes for children, the Wednesday Bible studies, and also Sudie Neeson Thompson's Presbyterian podcast. You'll find the links there and in the weekly word. Today's adult education class will be at 6 o'clock. It will be a virtual conversation with best-selling author Ibram X. Kendi, who will be talking about his best-selling book, How to Be an Anti-Racist. A class to discuss community policing will be offered Thursday at 7 o'clock. The link for both of those is in the online bulletin and the weekly word. The time with our children can be seen each week on Westminster's YouTube page. The easy way to find that is to just go to the homepage of our website and click on the little red YouTube icon. It will take you right to it. Beginning Sunday, November 22nd, and running for 3 consecutive Sundays, there'll be an adult education class for singles entitled Single, COVID-19, and the Holidays, How to Survive and Thrive. It'll be a Zoom discussion at 7 o'clock. You can find more information, again, in the online bulletin or in the weekly word. The Christmas Box Project is just now getting underway, and because of the coronavirus, it's going to be very different this year. I hope you'll take time to read about it. The most detailed part right now you can read is on the back page of the bulletin. Also, you can find information in the weekly word. If you brought an offering this morning, as you leave, you can place it in the blue box directly at the rear. Today's flowers are given to the glory of God and in memory of Amy Michener Lingle by her family. Husband Eric, children Katie, Jason, and Justin, and parents Bunny and Jack Michener. Now, let us worship God. We join together in our call to worship. We come together to thank the Creator of life. We come seeking truth, meaning, and hope.
Thank you.
We join together in our opening prayer, praying, Everlasting God, in whom we live and move and have our being, you have made us for yourself, so that our hearts are restless until they rest in you. Give us such a sense of purpose that no selfish passion may deter us from seeking your will, and no weakness prevent us from doing it. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Today's scripture reading comes from the book of Psalms, a very familiar psalm, the 90th psalm. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You turn us back to dust and say, Turn back, O mortals. For 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday, or like a watch in the night. You sweep them away, they are like a dream, like grass that is renewed in the morning. In the morning it flourishes and is renewed, in the evening it fades and withers. For we are consumed by your anger, by your wrath we are overwhelmed. You have set our iniquities before us, our secret sins in light of your countenance. For all our days pass away under your wrath, our years come to an end like a sigh. The days of our life are 70 years, or perhaps 80 if we are strong. Even then, their span is only toil and trouble. They are soon gone, and we fly away. Who considers the power of your anger? Your wrath is as great as the fear that is due you. So teach us to count our days, that we may gain a wise heart. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Whether the artist intended it or not, there is a painting hanging in the Prado Museum in Madrid, Spain, that stands as an interpretation of the 90th Psalm. On one side of the canvas, we see an attractive young woman. Next to her is an older woman whose body shows the sags and wrinkles of aging. She has her arm around the younger woman, and her eyes are riveted on her, as if to say, "I used to look like that." A fetching figure, supple skin, healthy hair. Her mouth is curved down in a grim expression. Next to the older woman, there's another figure, the Grim Reaper. He is holding in one hand an hourglass. His other arm is hooked into the older woman as if he is set to pull her away. The three figures convey the brevity of life. One day we are young, appealing, and energetic, and then, in what seems like no time at all, we are old and sluggish and our hair is thinning. Okay, vanishing. When we are young, time moves at a leisurely pace. 20 years after we graduate from high school, we say, "Gosh, seems like it's only been 10 years. Then as we get older, the pace races at a blinding pace. This painting in the Prado captures the feeling that life is slipping away. It's slipping away much faster than we ever would have imagined. The 90th Psalm captures the stark contrast between the eternal nature of God and the very finite nature of human beings. It expresses both comfort and frustration. Satisfaction that God is our dwelling place from everlasting to everlasting. And disgruntlement that life is sometimes a struggle and it is much, much too brief. The 90th Psalm arose among the Hebrew people during a time of calamity, not a global pandemic, but after a devastating defeat. The psalm opens on a reassuring note. "Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations." That is, not only now, but in every era, the people have recognized God as their secure harbor, their safe haven. The Lord is our dwelling place. This is a vital affirmation for all times, but it is especially significant for people who feel cut off from all that is familiar. Some Old Testament scholars believe that this was the context in which this psalm emerged. Jerusalem had been destroyed and the people had been dragged away to a foreign land. What a powerful passage for the people to sing. They have gathered together to worship, and they're choking back tears as they sing, "We have been ripped away from our homeland, but you, O God, you are our true home. Regardless of where we reside, you are our genuine dwelling place, and no one can sever our tie with you." There are 150 psalms in the Hebrew Psalter. How many of them do you think are attributed to Moses? This is the only one. Moses did not actually write it. It was written centuries after he had died. The people are feeling cut off from their homeland, and they are relating to what Moses must have felt like before he died. You remember that Moses returned to Egypt to free the Hebrew people, After wrestling around with Pharaoh, he finally liberates them, and then he takes them on this long trek, a 40-year journey through what is today the Sinai Peninsula and Jordan. And once they are on the brink of stepping into the land that they have been promised, when they are so close to it, they can see the rivers. They can smell the cedars. Moses died. He died on Mount Nebo, overlooking the land. From Mount Nebo, you can see the Dead Sea. Nearly his entire life had been wrapped up in leading the people to this land. He endured constant criticism of his leadership and faced numerous obstacles along the way. I suspect many times he was very tempted to give up on the dream of ever reaching the land. But with enormous fortitude and immense faith, he just kept forging on, pushing and pulling this bickering people along with him. And then when the finish line of this decades-long trek is in sight, his body gives out. He never actually set foot in the land to which he had been journeying most of his life. Today's psalm was written by people who were longing to be home, but knew that, like Moses, they might not get there. Their song affirmed that no matter where they were, they were with God, because God was their true home. One of the reasons this psalm has been so attractive through the ages is because it does not attempt to spread a sugar glaze over reality. It refuses to make the dubious claim that if your faith is strong, God will insulate you from the sharp blades of life. The anguish over life's trials gushes forth as they sing, God, you turn us back to dust. You sweep us away as if we were merely a dream. We are like grass that pops up in the morning, but by evening it withers. We might live to be 70, or if we're strong, may make 80. But life is a struggle, and in the blink of an eye, our time is up. Reminding us of the hardships of life, the psalm assaults us with words intended to remind us of the passage of time. Mortals, yesterday, morning, evening, days pass away, years come to an end. It is the ticking of the clock, constantly reminding us time is running out. So why this depressing declaration? Why must they pound away at the brevity of life? Why remind us that no matter how much we monitor our diet, no matter how many marathons we run, no matter how many things we still have to accomplish, life will come to an end, and it will be before we're ready. Author Jen Hatmaker writes, the average human gets around 25,000 days on Earth, and most of us in the U.S. will get a few more. That's it. Life is a breath. Heaven is coming fast, she writes, and we live in that thin space where faith and obedience have relevance. We have this one life to offer. There's no plan B. We get one shot at trying to expand the kingdom, at fighting injustice. We will stand before Jesus once. We will have one moment to say, this is how I lived. In Anne Rowe writes obituaries for The Economist magazine. She chooses people from around the globe who've died recently, and then she tries to capture the essence of their life in 1,000 words. I read one from a few years ago when two wealthy women from New York City died within a week of each other. It was Brooke Astor and Leona Helmsley. She wrote, "The concept of riches oblige has various dimensions. The bottom line is that anyone who has oodles of money is expected to give some of it away. The second to the bottom line is that they should cut a certain style while doing it." Both Brooke Astor and Leona Helmsley gave millions of dollars away, and their similarities ended there. She goes on, "Mrs. Astor was as small, delicate, and fine as a valuable porcelain cup. Her tailoring, exquisite, her jewels, unobtrusive. Mrs. Helmsley favored loud trouser suits and chunky diamond clips, with her mouth made big and cruel by scarlet lipstick. Mrs. Astor set great store by good manners, civility, and kind remarks. Mrs. Helmsley believed in loud words and elbows." How do you expect to be remembered? You are writing your obituary each day of your life. You may have heard about the interfaith panel that was discussing the differences and similarities among Christianity, Islam, and Judaism. It was a Christian minister, an imam, and a rabbi. Then at one point, the questioner said, "What do you hope people will say at your funeral?" The Christian minister said, "Well, I hope they will say that I extended the ministry of our church beyond our church walls." The imam said, "I hope they will say he had the interest of his congregation before his own interest." The rabbi said, "I hope they will say, look, he's moving." I suspect many of us will hope that it's not quite over yet, that we'll have a few more days. Then there's this part of the psalm that we choke on because it sounds so unlike Christ. The psalmist speaks of God's anger and wrath, but in fact, these are outgrowths of God's love. The prophets had warned the people that there would be consequences for neglecting justice and righteousness. And the psalmist interpreted their defeat by a foreign power as their just punishment. Last week, we looked at a passage from Romans when the apostle Paul called on us to hate what is evil. And that's because God hates evil. Thus, the psalmist says to God, "For we are consumed by your anger, by your wrath, we are overwhelmed." Keep in mind, God's wrath does not stem from a harsh judge who's reveling in punishment. It's from a loving creator who abhors injustice and cares what happens to each of God's children. There are consequences for wrong behavior. The fallout may come soon or may come eventually, but it will come. Returning to that painting in the Prado, I think the artist may have had Psalm 90 echoing in his soul, because at the bottom of his painting, he has painted an owl. the symbol of wisdom. It captures the final verse of our passage. Teach us, O God, to count our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Now, I am not encouraging us to dwell on death, but rather to be mindful of the precious nature of life. May we not squander the time we have. May we live a rich, full life, even if it's not as long as we would like. Our attitude will be a deciding factor on the quality of our life. Multiple sclerosis forced musician Jacqueline Dupre to stop performing at the young age of 28. By then, she was already regarded as one of the world's greatest cellists. Dupre entered her first solo competition when she was only 6 years old. On that day, she ran down the hall, carrying her cello over her head with a huge grin on her face. Someone standing nearby interpreted the child's demeanor as elation with the relief of having successfully completed her performance. He said to her, "I see you've just finished your chance to play." She said, "Oh no, I'm just about to." Her outlandish attitude characterized her short but legendary performing life. What a beautiful image to carry in our minds. What a beautiful way for us to begin each morning. I'm just about to. I'm just about to be with people I love. I'm just about to make my loved one's day a bit smoother. I'm just about to do the work I'm called to do. I'm just about to soak in the beauty of God's creation. I'm just about to extend kindness to a friend. I'm just about to be surprised by what today will bring. If we gain wise hearts before we come to the end of our days, we will have few regrets. We will be at peace. And we will be ready for the loving embrace from the one who has been our dwelling place and will forever be our dwelling place.
Thank you.
we join our hearts and minds in prayer. Eternal God, the one who was and is now and is to come, we struggle with knowing that in the long stretch of history, our time on earth is but a day. We often live as if we have all the time in the world, but living in the midst of a pandemic that has snatched the lives of more than a million worldwide, we are mindful of the fragile nature of life. An illness, an accident, a defective gene can sweep us or our loved one away at any moment. Gracious God, may we not be crippled by such knowledge and fall into despair. May we not allow our feelings of victimhood to generate every thought and action. Rather, may we use our understanding of the brevity of life to seize the opportunities of each day to live beautifully. May we fully embrace the commandment of Jesus to love you, to love ourselves, and to love others. May we trek the path of the prophet Micah by extending kindness, striving for justice, and walking humbly with you. May we be mindful of your gift of life and the opportunities that emerge each day. May we be awake to the impulses that harm and seek to replace them with powers that heal. May we overcome feelings of anger with love, envy with gratitude, greed with generosity, selfishness with compassion, and revenge with forgiveness. Loving God, though our years are brief, may our spirits be alive. Though troubles assail us, may we face them undaunted. Jesus revealed ways to make new music. May we have the wisdom to embrace beauty and to create moments of joy, so that we may have the comfort of being in harmony with you and be able to live valiantly in hope. And now, O Lord, we join our voices and pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Sorry.
have but one life, so let us live it abundantly. And now may God's love, joy, and hope be yours this day and forever. Amen.